Shalom, shalom, saints. This is Pastor John Tatum, and you're listening to KYCN Radio. The Kingdom of Israel Community Network.
Subscribe and click on the bell icon today and receive weekly updates of news and events. And all new apostolic and prophetic revelation from Shaleakh Yashah ben Yeshua. To access this epistle in written form, click on the link in the description box below or visit www.tcvi.org/resources. Apostolic Doctrine. The House of David. Messianic Polygyny. And in that day, seven women shall take hold of one man, saying, "We will eat our own bread, and wear our own apparel, only let us be called by your name, to take away our reproach." Isaiah 4:1. For the ancient Israelites, the manifestation of kingdom order in their midst set them apart from all the other great nations of the ancient world, head and shoulders above the pagan goddess-worshipping heathen round about. And in ordering the families of Israel, the use of polygyny, the practice of one man having more than one wife, was not uncommon, especially among the great patriarchs of the faith. Abraham, Jacob, Moses, David, and many others, had more than one wife. The great lawgiver Moshe, who commanded that adulterers should be stoned to death, made provisions for polygyny in the Torah, and under certain circumstances, even required it as a matter of law. Deuteronomy 25:5 and 21:15-17. Hear, O Israel, the original promise to our father Abraham, that he would be the father of many nations, was itself a call to polygyny. Therefore, it is written of Abraham, "But unto the sons of the concubines which Abraham had, Abraham gave gifts, and sent them away from Isaac his son, while he yet lived, eastward, unto the east country." Genesis 25:6. And as it is written, "And if you be Christ's, then are you Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise." Galatians 3:29. As of this year, some 80%+ of the world's societies practice polygyny. And yet, according to statistics, the Western world, which considers polygyny to be immoral, leads the world in adultery, divorce, abortion, rape, and prostitution. Salah. Nevertheless, the issue of biblical polygyny still stirs great wrath among those born and raised under Hellenistic philosophies and influence. Clearly, Western theologians interpret Hebrew Yisraelite scripture with a Greco-Roman cultural bias. How then could they not conclude that the New Covenant condemns the practice of polygyny? And the end result has been that the vast majority of the household of faith, and so-called black people in particular, are completely unaware of the long-standing history of messianic polygyny. Blessing. As we so often prophesy, true biblical marriage is being restored to the supposed African-American people at this very hour. Why? The truth is, the revelation of polygyny in Messiah is the key, not only to setting messianic Christian families in order, but to preparing the true churches for Yeshua. Hear, O Israel, the marriage of Christ and his bride is a plural marriage. For example, in the Song of Solomon, which is by all accounts a glorious prefiguring of Messiah's love for his church, It was said to King Solomon by his wife, the Shulamite, "Your name is as ointment poured forth, therefore, do the virgins love you? Draw me, and we will run after you." Song of Solomon 1, 3-4. Messiah himself revealed messianic polygyny, in his betrothal to the church, through his parable of the 10 virgins, see Matthew 25, 1-13. Remember, Messiah lived and taught outside of the context of Greco-Roman marriage, i.e., mandatory monogamy, bridesmaids, etc. To be sure, there is only one church, or set-apart government. But there are many varied aspects of the light of Messiah, that are of necessity, reflected and highlighted by various congregations. And beyond dispensationalism, this is why Messiah, in his very revelation to the world, chose to address seven churches, rather than the whole nation at once, revealing yet another reflection of the spiritually polygynous nature of YAH. As we have consistently pointed out, it's no coincidence that the nation of Yisrael, the very root and foundation of true messianic faith, sprang forth from our father Jacob and his four wives. To suggest that polygyny constitutes adultery is to suggest that ancient Yisrael was a nation of bastards. Selah. Would the Most High, pristine in his holiness, enter into a sacred oath with a cursed people? YAH forbid. Moreover, in the book of Revelation, which is after all a part of the new covenant, it is written that the names of the 12 sons, resulting from Jacob's polygynous relationships, are permanently enshrined in the gates of the holy city, the New Jerusalem. Revelation 21:12. This is the very abode of YAH himself. How then can we dare suggest that messianic polygyny is sinful? Again, YAH forbid. And again, allegorically speaking, even YAH himself is polygynous. It is written, "The word of YAH came again to me, saying, Son of man, there were two women, the daughters of one mother. They committed harlotry in Egypt, they committed harlotry in their youth, their breasts were there, embraced. Their virgin bosom was there, pressed. Their names, Aholah, the elder, and Aholibah, her sister, they were mine, and they bore sons and daughters. As for their names, Samaria is Aholah, and Jerusalem is Aholibah." Ezekiel 23, 1-4. Hear, O Yisrael, as a critical point of truth, without a revelation of the spiritual polygyny of our Father YAH and our Messiah Yeshua, we simply cannot fully understand how YAH operates his creation, how Messiah administrates his church, or how to fully discern the Father's perfect will for our lives, families, congregations, and communities. Disinheritance. The ancient prophets of Yisrael prophesied in the Spirit that because of backsliding and rebellion, in the course of time, the covenant blessings, including polygyny, would be stripped from the nation, for a season. As it is written, "For the children of Yisrael shall abide many days without a king, and without a prince, and without a sacrifice, and without an image, and without an ephod, and without teraphim." Hosea 3:4. Even so, biblical polygyny will once again prove to be a critical key to restoring our overall national inheritance in Messiah. Over the last 17 centuries or so, multiplied millions of the faithful have been misled into believing that an ideal marriage is composed of one man and one woman. But in truth, this sacred cow of Greco-Roman theology is nothing more than a religious facade and a genocidal alternative to biblical polygyny, right along with adultery, fornication, prostitution, forced abstinence, forced celibacy, and serial polygamy. And of course, many of us have come to believe that plural marriage is just another fleshly practice, and is actually a part of the problem, rather than the solution. For example, polygyny's opponents cite rape, child molestation, and forced marriages with underage girls as undesirable aspects of polygyny, and thus reasons to reject it. But in point of truth, these tendencies are manifested just as often in so-called monogamous marriages. Obviously, these kinds of abuses should be rejected and punished in all instances, but based upon the actual offenses involved, whatever the marital arrangement happens to be. But beyond that, there are some very basic problems with mandatory monogamy. It's not in the script. It forces large numbers of righteous women to remain single, or worse. In cases where a wife cannot bear children, it makes it impossible for a man to produce an heir, without divorce. For the most part, the monumental error of mandatory monogamy is sustained by a poor translation of the Apostle Paul's directive, recorded in 1 Timothy and Titus, requiring bishops to be, quote, the husband of one wife. It therefore becomes needful to understand what was actually being taught about marriage in this epistle. To begin with, in chapter 5 of that same epistle, the apostle writes that a widow should not be taken under the financial care of the church, unless she has been the wife of one man. 1 Timothy 5:9. But the word one in that passage is hais, which is the Greek word for the actual number one. Paul was clearly teaching that such a woman had to have been the wife of only one husband, in other words, a woman free of adultery. It was not merely by chance that a completely different word for one was used when referring to the qualifications for a bishop. The Greek word meia was used in the passage, a bishop must then be blameless, the husband of one wife. 1 Timothy 3:2. In other words, although the Greek word meia can accurately be translated as one, given the fact that a totally different Greek word for one was used in this passage, a more accurate translation of meia into English in this particular instance is first. And certainly, those who later translated the Greek translation of the New Testament into English were Hellenized, and thus translating from a culturally biased, non-Hebraic frame of reference. Rather than forbidding a bishop to practice polygyny, the Apostle Paul was simply saying that a bishop must be a man who has remained faithful to his first wife, a man free of adultery. In both instances, the issue isn't polygyny, it's adultery, or the breaking of wedlock, the Hebraic/Mosaic laws of which are different for male and female. Secondly, most Hellenized biblical scholars point to Adam and Eva, Adam and Eve, as proof that monogamy is YAH's ideal form of marriage. One man, one woman. But in truth, when the two became one flesh, the marital equation became 1 plus 1 equals 1. And without violating the original intent of YAH, for the creation of male and female, this divine arithmetic clearly allows for 1 plus 1 plus 1 equals 1 as well. Thirdly, a major rationale for the remnant continuing in mandatory monogamy is supposed obedience to the Apostle Peter's directive to the church, to submit yourselves to every ordinance of man. In other words, Christians/Messianics should only enter into, quote, legal marriages, which include a marriage license from the state. But the word ordinance in that passage is simply referring to the form of government, as in whether it be to the king as supreme, or unto governors, etc., not to blindly following every man-made doctrine or ungodly statute. Following that line of reasoning, the original disciples of Messiah were wrong for preaching the gospel, since it caused them to be jailed as violators of the law. Selah. Furthermore, the Apostle Paul instructed us to forsake worldly courts, to judge even the smallest disputes among the saints, see 1 Corinthians 6, 1-8. How much more then should we recognize that the true authority to sanction our marriages in the sight of YAH rests squarely upon the shoulders of the faithful remnant alone? In truth, placing our marriages in the hands of the state has resulted in unheard-of levels of divorce, and actually led to rampant adultery as well. For example, if a man were to put away a YAH-ordained wife in a no-fault divorce, the state, and tragically, most churches, would then grant him continued good standing in their respective communities, and even sanction another marriage that YAH himself has deemed unlawful. Historically speaking, it wasn't until the onset of European incursion into the New World in 1492, that the authority to sanction marriage was moved from the Church alone, into an alliance with the state, by decree of the Vatican. So then, were all the marriages in the Most High, that occurred in the nearly 1500 years before that point, illegitimate? Obviously not. As it is written, what YAH has joined together, let not man put asunder. Finally, brethren, coming full circle, this whole dynamic played itself out in the first family of faith. The reason Sarah's handmaid Hagar despised her, when she became with child by Abraham, was that Hagar then assumed she had the right to claim Abraham exclusively. Unlike the free woman, the mighty woman of faith, Sarah, Hagar was an Egyptian slave, who cherished the mandatory monogamy practiced by the common people of her mother nation. Rather than submit to Abraham's YAH-ordained, patriarchal and polygynous family structure, she remained loyal to her slave heritage, and she raised her son accordingly. Was this the gratitude Sarah deserved for sharing her husband with her handmaid? Selah. Notice that when Hagar finally fled from Sarah's indignation, the angel of YAH sent to comfort her did not agree with her stand for mandatory monogamy. Instead, he told her to return and submit to her mistress, the head wife, Sarah. Hagar returned, but refused to submit. The enduring rift between Isaac and Ishmael, between Israelites and Arabs, between the Torah and the Quran, is the devastating result. Restoration. According to the scriptures, the sun, moon, and stars typify the family and governmental authority. It is written, He gave the lesser light to rule the night. I, for one, am fully persuaded that every foul spirit of darkness that would keep this controversy boiling will soon end up where they belong, under the feet of the daughters of Abraham. We are now living in the age when the prophecy of Yeshayahu Isaiah concerning seven women taking hold of one man must be fulfilled, especially among Hebrew Yisraelites, the supposed African American people. If for no other reason, then as a matter of sheer survival. In most societies, including America, it often comes down to basic arithmetic. Women simply outnumber men. And when you add to that the huge, disproportionate number of Israelite men in prison, the problem for our people becomes even more acute. In many instances, unmarried women, many of them with children, who need a strong man of YAH, are called to plural marriage by necessity. For these causes, the Holy Spirit leads men and women in diverse ways, for the overall benefit of the family, the community, and the kingdom. In the final analysis, the truth of the matter is, the Babylonian Greco-Roman doctrine, and pseudo-practice of mandatory monogamy, is in truth, a manifestation of the spirit of Jezebel. Salah. Nevertheless, take heart, sons of Yah. For just as the spirit of Elijah overcame the spirit of rebellion in Ahab and Jezebel, and the same spirit in Yochanan did the same to prepare the way for Messiah, so the spirit of Jezebel, slandering the kingdom order of family in our generation, shall soon be overcome. Hear, O Israel, polygyny is not only acceptable in the beloved, it is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. Rejoice, you set apart ones, and be glad. For YAH has chosen to restore kingdom order to the lost found Yisraelite commonwealth in our own generation, including the divine polygynous family order of our father Abraham, the fulfillment of the great promise, and the glorious kingdom shalom that shall most assuredly be the result. YAH Khai VeHalleluYAH. It's kingdom time.
If you enjoyed this program, don't forget to hit the subscribe button and bell icon at youtube.com/KYCN Media and receive instant notifications from KYCNradio.com, your official Yisraelite voice for the gathering of the people. Be sure to tune in every Saturday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time for more groundbreaking revelation from our Rod of Iron program with Shaleakh Yashah on KYCNradio.com. Until next week, Shabbat Shalom, and YAH Khai VeHalleluYAH.
Shalom, shalom, saints. This is Pastor John Tatum, and you're listening to KYCN Radio.